classified by one. Unfortunately, it's a private law. Ask Romanian hackers. There are many stories about their successful police investigations and arrests, and sometimes they report the numbers. And one of the stories which still is under investigation, it happened in November last year. Cyber criminals, they got access to their American bank, and they got the database of credit cards. And they printed their fake credit cards using this data, and they distributed it around the globe to the street criminals. And the first part of the story, that was cyber criminals, which got all this data stolen from the bank. And the rest of the story, that's a street criminals. And this is such an organization that in 49 cities around the globe, from United States to China, and the list of cities, there's a New York, Moscow, Hong Kong. Within half an hour, hundreds of street criminals came to the cash machines, to the bank, and they got $9 million. So not before, not after, just within half an hour. And as far as I know, some people said that FBI, they are crying like a baby, because they have just three pictures of the very best quality of three Africans coming to their cash machines, and they were looking for them, so they have a picture. They don't have any real data. Well, there are two other stories there. They have a happy end because the criminals were arrested. The first story happened in Russia, in one of the Ural cities. Russian hackers, they hijacked the cash machine, and they changed, so they got access to the computer in their bank, and they changed their exchange ratio. So they sent ruble 50 times more expensive than the reality. And they exchanged $800 American dollars to some million rubles, and actually that was 1 million rubles. So that's quite a good rate. Yeah. They were arrested. And another story. It's about Sumitomo Bank. It's a famous story, and probably it's a world largest robbery in the history. Do you remember the story that British criminals back in 1960-something, they stopped the train which transported cash from Glasgow to London, as far as I remember. And that was a big story. There were a couple of movies recorded about that. And that was, these criminals, they were arrested, they became stars. But they got about £40 million stolen. In this case, the cyber criminals, they were about to have £229 million stolen from the bank accounts, from the Sumitomo. It's a Japanese bank, and they attacked the branch of the Japanese bank in London. And actually, they did it with the help of their Trojan program, with a keylogger, with the help of insider. Usually, banks are protected, but they're insiders. And with a couple of insiders, they got access to the computer system in the bank, and they installed keylogger. And they got all the data which is typed by bank employees, and what's that? It's the passwords and logins to the transaction service. So they got all this data, and they came to the bank on Friday in 2005, I think, as far as I remember. And they tried to make all these transactions. But they were IT guys. They were professional in computers, not in financial transactions. So they didn't fill the form in the right way. So the transaction was simply rejected. And they came on Saturday to fix it, and they were arrested. Because this bank security got their information about some unsuccessful transactions. So they were, but if they had a financial guy, $500 million. Yes, America, it's a British pound, so it's about $500 million American dollars will disappear from Sumitomo bank accounts. So, unfortunately, this business is profitable. But actually, it's quite simple. This is just a software. This is just a software. They don't need to leave the room if they have a internet connection. They're just sitting somewhere, probably in Bahamas, developing malware, distributing that. That's simple. Another reason why it's easy for them, it's a mental reason. The street criminals, they are in touch with the victims. So they see a person which has been under the attack. Cyber criminals, they in touch with a keyboard. The victim is somewhere over there, in a different time zone, in a different country, and they will never meet. So, and even so, cyber criminals, they don't really understand that they are real persons which have been hijacked. But the main reason why it's so simple to develop malware, I think, is the fact that modern operating systems, they have a weak design, weak structure, weak security, and this is the main reason why it's so simple to attack the computers. Because there are modern operating systems, Linux, Windows, Mac, they allow to run unknown and untrusted applications. And low-risk business. Well, actually, there are many reasons why it's, the police is not so effective to find, to locate and isolate cyber criminals. Well, there are hundreds of arrests around the globe, but there are 10,000 or 100,000 cyber criminals active in the internet. So it's just the arrests, it's just the top of the iceberg. So it's really nothing, it doesn't affect cyber crime. And there are several reasons for that. First of all, it's the victims, they don't report. Their individuals, sometimes they take it as a simple risk and they report to the bank, for example, and bank simply returns money back. And businesses, they don't report because it's a negative impact on the reputation. So unfortunately, police sometimes doesn't really know about this attacks. They also get in the national laws. For example, they abuse protected hosting. We know this type of criminal activity in the internet. There was a very successful PR for the Russian business network, RBN. Well, thanks for me, because this is a Russian business network, so it's criminal, so they put extra attention to this. There are many such networks in the world, and still there are no laws to arrest these guys. So there are no acts in a criminal court to arrest people which are responsible for these almost criminal types of services. But the main reasons why it's not so easy to catch the cyber criminals in the internet is the fact that they are professional and they're anonymous. And it's very difficult to trace the person in the internet if this person is professional. Many people think that, ordinary people think that they are anonymous in the internet. So they go to the web page, they go to the weblog, and they post something using the leak. They think they are anonymous. No. If you have a direct connection to the resource, the provider is catching your IP, so if police comes, they will disclose you. It's quite simple. But if they use proxy servers in different parts of the globe, forget about tracing the criminal. And their main reason is also that cyber criminals, they operate in the internet. Internet is a country with a, it's a different dimension. It's a country which doesn't have border. But national police departments, they're disconnected by national borders. And that's very difficult to get police departments to connect them to investigate their cyber crime. So, do you have anything to add to the list? It's profitable, it's easy, it's low risk business. Anything else?
Perfect business.
No. Perfect business is develop protection against it. So, well, actually there are three reasons. And to stop cybercrime, just to eliminate it, we have to eliminate one of these reasons or two or three of them, right? If there are no reasons for cybercrime, it will disappear. Okay, let's try to fix these three reasons one by one. And first of all, profit. It's profitable. It's very profitable business because there are a lot of money in the internet. A lot of money. Who doesn't use internet for transactions? Who doesn't use their eBay system, their online shops or others? Anyone here in the room who doesn't use it? Come on, come on. I'm sure that there are some people.
Everybody uses it.
I don't use it. I'm paranoid. Well, I'm kidding, of course. Sometimes when it's not possible to find other service, I do it as well. So everyone uses it. And actually that means that in the internet a lot of money. And this is a place where the services, money, and of course criminals which want to take your money. And to stop it, we have to stop the services. Just to decrease the amount of money in the internet. Did anyone send paper email for last year? For a couple of years? I didn't. Well, actually, that's so fortunately or unfortunately, there will be a lot of services, a lot of money in the internet, in mobile phones, in I don't know where, in the new innovations, new technologies. So actually, it's not possible to stop cyber criminals by fixing the reason number one. Okay, reason number two. Operating systems, which are flexible and insecure. All of them are. But most of them, all popular operating systems, they are flexible and insecure. Is it possible to design secure operating system? Yes. And actually there were several examples of secure operating systems. It's like a Symbian 9, like Brew operating system. And security means that only trusted applications are allowed to be executed in a secure environment. Trust means that every application has to have some ID. It has to have a cryptographic signature, fingerprint, or it has to be listed in the whitelist system or any other system which registers the applications. That means that software vendors have to stay in line waiting for certificates. Well, actually, we do that with Symbian, and sometimes that's you have to wait for months to get a certificate. And actually, with the software industry, it simply doesn't work at all. I know many companies, they just stopped developing software for Symbian. Then Symbian turned to the secure design of the operating system. So, as a result, there are more and more services for insecure but flexible operating systems and a less applications, less services of secure operating systems. And recently I got a
our system administrators, they were looking in my company, they were looking for the solution to have their secure connection to the corporate environment from the smartphone. And they tried many of them, BlackBerry, iPhone, others, and finally they decided that the only way to have a secure connection in our way is the HTTP system, because they have applications, they have services, which Apple doesn't have, BlackBerry doesn't have. So sometimes when you buy something, you have to, but you buy because this particular hardware has a service, has an application, this has a system, has an application which works. So unfortunately, secure operating systems, they lose to flexible systems. If the customer comes to the shop, imagine that there are two devices. One is secure, but with a low list, with a short list of services, and another device is insecure, but with a full set of applications, services, hotels. Most of people will buy insecure ones. So, unfortunately,
security is not hidden in this case. And even, it's not even about security. It's about the behavior of the software, of the operating system vendor. Even more friendly vendors, they've been over not so friendly. Do you remember such a name like a Novell, OS2? Does anyone still use it? Anyone here in the room? One. And the main reason was then IBM and Novell, they were watching their software industry like some addiction. They do some something for this operating system. At the same time, Microsoft for building community of software engineers to develop more and more and more software. So it's not even this, it's not even security versus flexibility. It's like, are you friendly or not? So the more friendly systems, more friendly vendors, they win over not so friendly. So Microsoft, they built their community of software engineers or software companies, which developed their more and more software, more services for this operating system. I don't want to say that Microsoft Windows is better than Novell or better than OS2 technically, simply because they are winners in this competition simply because they were more friendly with software engineers. There's one more proof why secure operating system can't win over their flexible operating system. And by the way, now the situation is almost same. Google is building the community for Android. They are attracting more and more software engineers and companies to develop more and more software for Android. At the same time, Apple and BlackBerry, they have quite a strict rules for the software industry. Actually, we still don't have permission from Apple to develop antivirus for iPhone. We need the permission for it. So, I bet that in 5 years, if Apple and BlackBerry don't change their mind, they will be in the